The project today is to find a way of fitting a second battery into the Defender 110. This is the current arrangement in the battery box. Quite a big battery in there, so the plan is to turn that one through 90 degrees and put it over there, and to fit a second leisure battery in this space here. I need to get rid of these clips, which were originally for the tire lever. May have to relocate this relay. I think it's just a standard relay, and that one's a timer relay for the heated rear screen. With that cable there is an addition, because I don't think a heated front screen is standard on this model. So the plan at the moment is to take the existing battery out, do some measuring, get rid of these clips down here, work out how to make up a plate to go on the floor to level up the bottom of the battery cabinet, and also scheme a way of making up a suitable bracket to hold both batteries in place once they're both here. Current plan is to use a low profile leisure battery. I'll talk a little bit more about the kind of battery I'm going to go for a little further on in the video, but having gone the full spectrum from lithium at lots and lots of dosh, I decided to go for something a little bit more affordable, shall we say. One thing I have decided is I'm going to use a battery to battery charging system rather than the more standard is kind of relay system, and the system I've gone for is probably a bit of overkill, but this is quite a nice system. Then you can set up the charging profile for whatever battery you have. So if I do decide to go for lithium further down the road, then this bad boy can cope with it. The plan is to squeeze the two batteries in parallel, and for the battery to battery charger to fit on the back wall here. I need to also check on the ventilation requirements for the battery to battery charger. It does have fans on it. Don't really want to cut holes in the box. So it's relatively dry at the moment, but these things do seem to attract water and mud. Anyway, we'll see how we go. It's just a sort of an introduction at this stage, and I'll do some updates as the plan comes together. One thing I do need to sort out is where this red coming off the negative earth side of the battery's going to. It's an interesting piece of wiring by a previous owner. So I had a crisis of confidence about whether my proposed auxiliary battery would actually fit in the remaining space, not only as to whether it would fit in the space, but whether I could get it in or out of the space, because there's quite a significant lip here between the opening into the battery compartment and the outside edge of the seat box. So there's that much space that you can't drop something directly into the hole. So my fake battery proves to me that with a bit of a struggle, it is possible to fit the battery that I'm hoping to use into the box. This is what I'm going to use to mount my dual batteries. It's been adapted from a Wolf battery carrier, which I guess must have been used for the Odyssey sort of sized batteries. It's about 250 mm long, which is significantly less than my battery, but the advantage of this is it's got two horizontal packing pieces, and the bolts already in the right position to locate perfectly. Let's have a look in here, in holes that are pre-drilled in the bottom of the battery compartment, there, and over there. So I'll just pop the battery carrier in. So here the battery carrier's in place. Not that easy to see, but you can see it's actually sits really nicely down into those locating and securing holes. And the next stage is going to be adding a little bit of extra protection and a little bit more leveling up to cope with a little bit more of a lip that we have on this side. This actually slopes up a bit, which reduces the width across the battery compartment. So to get around that, I've got some thick heavy duty foam that's going to sit across each battery tray. That's a double benefit of protecting the bottom of the battery, but also giving me just a little bit more length on the battery compartment. So there, that's the piece of foam in place. You can see the thickness of that is very high density kind of stuff, and it's going to give the battery a nice comfy bed. Okay, so I'm conscious I missed one or two stages here, but it's really quite difficult to film this and do this at the same time. But what you can actually see here is the first real live trial fit of the AGM battery in place next to a new vehicle battery. The old one turned out to have a dead cell. The battery device is happily installed. I had to shift the relays for the heated front windscreen, and I've added wiring for linking the main vehicle battery to the battery to battery charger. And in the next clip I'll show you the cables made up for those, or rather the cables that I have made up for those connected up to the batteries. But essentially the vehicle battery connects into that side of the battery to battery charger via a couple of cables. One of them's an earth cable that runs along here and will go onto the pole, which is just underneath there. The other one is that cable there, which is coming, or will come, from the live terminal of the vehicle battery to a 30 amp fuse there on the side bulkhead, which then runs down across there and onto the battery to battery charger. The output side of the battery to battery box comes up here. It goes via that piece of conduit with an inline fuse, which is there, you can just see, and that comes up then and is going to a mudstuff box, which has got the Eberspacher in, and you can probably just see a fuse box which is taking the live to a buzz bar. The neutral stroke earth isn't connected yet. So the only other thing to mention is that cable there, that basically taken from a live point on the vehicle wiring system, which is live when the engine is up and running, which means that this battery to battery system can't discharge the vehicle battery unless the engine is running. I may actually add a timer to that, so the battery to battery charger doesn't cut in for a few minutes until after the vehicle has actually started. And I'll also probably add a switch so it can't cut in at all if I choose not to, if I think the vehicle battery is low and needs a bit of a run before the AGM battery starts to get a sniff of the charge. Here's everything fitted. It is pretty snug, but it all goes. So as you can see, the battery size there is 019 for the vehicle battery, which is oversized for a Defender, but it fits in quite nicely. This AGM battery, I haven't actually got the size type for it, but it's the same height, 190 mm, and the same width as the starter battery. It's just a little bit shorter. You probably could fit in an 019, but I haven't tried that. But this one fits in quite nicely. I'll just give you the size for that. Yeah, this one's 315 mm long. I think this one's 350, 353, something like that. So I hope that helps, even if it only confirms that you can actually squeeze these in without buying very expensive battery of the Odyssey type. So this is quite a lot more affordable, and I think, don't quote me on this, that the CCA ratings are probably higher. So all good. I've got good clearance here between the positive terminal and the top of the seat box cover, and I've got this really nice thick insulated cover over there, and this is rock solid. It's not going anywhere. So jobs are good. I just need to test the battery to battery charger next, and I'll do one more short clip on that when that's completed. Last job is to run this cable to a suitable location on the vehicle, which is live when the engine's running. And I'm also going to put a voltage indicator on so I can see what the charge is doing and the state of charge of the battery. So that's what the next section will show, hopefully.